the SEC on ESPN. And tonight, conference play begins with a bang. If history is any indication, this one will go to the wire, because six of the last eight between South Carolina and Georgia have been decided by 6 points or less. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick, Craig James, it's great to have you with us. Georgia's Joe Cox waited a long time to be the number one quarterback for this team, but earlier this week, the rumors started flying that he'd already lost his job. Heather Cox, what's the story?
Well, indeed, Mike, the rumors started flying on Thursday and spread like wildfire that Joe Cox would not start due to injury, and that his backup, Logan Gray, would. I have confirmed with head coach Mark Richt that Joe Cox will get the start, but he is battling a sore shoulder. He told me it's caused by nerve damage that's caused some muscle atrophy, so he took Wednesday off, didn't throw, hoping to keep it fresh. Now, that said, we will see Logan Gray more than normal. They do have a red zone package in place for him, and I've been told we might see him in other situations as well. And guys, don't forget, Joe Cox has been battling the flu the last 2 weeks. He's down 9 pounds because of it, so strength overall could certainly be an issue.
Thanks very much. Georgia lost its opener on the road to Oklahoma State, Craig. They're not used to being 0-1 around here, and the last thing they want to do is start 0-2.
Well, you know what, and I think the last thing that South Carolina needs to do is to read the newspapers and think that Joe Cox might not be a good football player, that his shoulder may be weak. Far from it. This guy has 2 career starts. He has 14 appearances. It's not like he has a ton of experience, but he is a senior. He's a leader. He wants to be a football coach down the road. He has to execute tonight, and if his wide receivers will make some catches and not some of those drops they did last week, he'll have more success.
When you think about Steve Spurrier, Coach Steve's the first thing that pops into your mind is offense, but it's his defensive unit that right now is by far his best group.
And he's leaning on them heavily, you know, but they need to get away from that. If they want to win on the road, they've got to come up with an offensive line and Steven Garcia making some throws down the field. We're going to really track that tonight. Play action passes against the Georgia aggressive linebackers, that little softness behind them, and the throws down the field. Only about 3 of them last week against NC State. They have to push the football if they're going to have any chance of being successful.
It's a jam-packed Sanford Stadium, 92,000 on hand as the Georgia Bulldogs begin their 81st season at this historic facility. And here come the Georgia Bulldogs. We're moments away from kickoff between the hedges. Georgia, South Carolina, the SEC on ESPN. Welcome back to Athens. There's plenty on our menu tonight. Craig's Pony Express will discuss how Matthew Stafford's selection and Sam Bradford's injury will influence a lot of decisions. We'll flash back to a famous meeting in the series and see if you can remember 2 great backs. And we'll bring you some of the sights and sounds from the vibrant town of Athens and the campus at the University of Georgia. Perfect night for football, just a beautiful September evening in the heart of Georgia. Mark Richt won more than 80 games his first 8 years, just a remarkable record. And Steve Spurrier, who had such great success at Florida, it has yet to translate to the same kind of numbers at South Carolina, but he has made them respectable and competitive, something that they were not before.
Some coaches just have a way of game planning for certain opponents, and Steve Spurrier, competitive juices, tactical X's and O's, has one for Georgia.
Chris Culliver is deep to receive the Georgia kick, and Blair Walsh has it teed up at the 30. Culliver has returned 2 kicks this year, averaged almost 20 yards in return. You'd almost want to think about kicking off anytime you had the opportunity today, considering how good these defenses have been. Culliver, 5 yards deep, will take a knee.
South Carolina, the game not winning.
Steven Garcia will lead the South Carolina offense, named the starter after the spring. He is the only quarterback on the roster with game experience. 6 touchdown passes, 8 interceptions a year ago. Last week against North Carolina State, 1 pick. He threw for 148 yards. Those are his numbers from a year ago. Brian Maddox will be his running back on 1st and 10 from the 20. South Carolina ran twice as many times last week as it threw. They come out rolling, and on 1st down, they'll pick up 6 on the toss to the sideline, and it's the fullback. DeMarco makes the catch. Let's take a look at tonight's impact players, brought to you by Dave and Buster's.
Mo Brown had a career game last year against Georgia. 7 catches, 130 yards, a touchdown. Devin Taylor, his first and only career start. He was off the charts crazy. And Eric Norwood, number 40, a linebacker, simply one of the best playmaking defenders in the country.
2nd and 4. Receivers. Garcia wants to throw again. High, but caught, and should be enough for a 1st down. That's his tight end, Wesley Saunders, who had 4 grabs a week ago in the opener. Rennie Curran, the tackling machine for Georgia, was right there.
During film study, one of the weaknesses that I felt Georgia's defense had last week against Oklahoma State was their play-action defense. They're not seeing folks underneath. This is exactly where Steven Garcia and Steve Spurrier need to attack.
See a draw play, only for a couple for Maddox. He's brought down by Brandon Boykin up from the left corner.
College football's gotten such that when you have 2 teams so close like you have here tonight, the coaching staff, when they look at game film and they look and try to analyze the weakness of an opponent, when you have 1 weakness over there, which right now I think South Carolina sees in Georgia's pass defense, you have to be successful with it. Garcia will give him confidence early.
2nd and call at 9 from the South Carolina 32. 4-man rush, and they got him. Garcia stepped up in the pocket, and there was no place to step up to. Cornelius Washington was there. Garcia has felt pressure and taken off in the past.
Absolutely he has. Well, tonight he didn't have anywhere to go on that particular one right there. It happened so fast, the pocket collapsed. This Georgia defense is extremely fast. Faster than last week's opponent for South Carolina's O-line. They've got to make the adjustment.
3rd and long. Garcia draw play. Bryce Sherman got the carry. And that'll bring on the kicking unit.
Gives you a little feel right there how Spurrier's thinking. 3rd and 12, 13. We're not going to throw it. Think back to the old fun and gun days. We'd have seen the football down the field.
But he knows the strength of this team is his defense right now. Spencer Lanning to kick it away, and Prince Miller is back at his 25. Now Georgia grabs a couple of blockers back there. Returnable kick, but Miller can't get up there, takes it on the hop. And then pays the price, swarmed under at the 25-yard line. Return of 3 after a punt of 46. The 46 yards, the result of a fortuitous bounce. Joe Cox, the senior from Charlotte, North Carolina, in high school, set all sorts of records. Played behind Matthew Stafford. That's a tough place to be if you want to get some playing time. But it's his team now. Last week, 50% on his pass completions against Oklahoma State. A touchdown and a pick. Fake to Samuel. Cox pump fake. Deep and knocked away. The quick weakness of that secondary, Chris Culliver. The safety came over. They tried to get it in between the corner and the safety for A.J. Green, the brilliant wide receiver, but Culliver wasn't having any of it.
How about a statement pass right here? Joe Cox, we talked about him maybe not playing this week, maybe a weak shoulder, weak arm, and he goes down the field, pushes it down to A.J. Green. That right there will tell that South Carolina defense they better be ready for the deep ball.
You will see the South Carolina defense is remarkably quick. Corner blitz coming. Green fumble. South Carolina has it. Culliver picked it up on the bounce. Augusti knocked it away. He had man-to-man coverage on the outside, and Culliver was there for the recovery. That's what defense can do.
Mike, it's what defense can do for you if you get a lot of your teammates around the football, which is what they do at South Carolina. They pursue the football. A.J. Green, the best receiver in the SEC, trying to do something extra. And around the football, South Carolina's defense, Culliver's there to make the play.
Watching part of the game you did a week ago, Craig, when they played against North Carolina State, I have never seen a South Carolina defense that they've had some good ones. But these guys are really fast.
And against NC State in that game, they created a turnover in the very first play of the game.
Jarvis Giles, a highly recruited running back, is in for the first time. He wears number 3s out of Tampa, Florida. And a whistle will delay the play.
Before the snap, delay of game, number 5 on the offense, 5-yard penalty.
What a monster upset that is. Here is the heralded Giles. Got a nice block from Patrick DeMarcos, the nephew of the pro golfer, Chris DeMarco. Chris doesn't get to hit anybody like that.
Jump back a little bit on Wendy Nix's report, though. How about the University of Houston beating Oklahoma State? We kept watching the score all afternoon, Mike, and we were like, can you believe this? Houston has a great offense. Oklahoma State, the big opening day game, and they win at home, and everybody's excited. Boy, that's a deep leader.
Biggest win the Houston program has had in years and years. Garcia, pressure coming, locks it for the end zone, incomplete. Hung that ball up, and it was just off of the fingertips of Torrey Gurley, and he was covered by Boykin. But that was a jump ball, and neither man could come down with it.
Yeah, but Gurley, with his height, Gurley has to make this play. He had 4 catches in game 1. He's got the advantage. He's there. The ball's in his hands. He has to make the play for Steven Garcia. Give the guy a chance. That's a catchable
football. That was catchable, wasn't it? And if you're not familiar with the name, Gurley went by the name of Tony Childers a year ago. He changed the name to honor his late father. Garcia again, pressure coming from behind. He can run, then he throws. Saunders, the big tight end, barrels to the 1. Oh, what a good play by Garcia to get away from the pressure and then make the decision for the little flip throw.
Last week, several times under pressure, Garcia would tuck and he took off running. He forgot about his receivers that were down the field for him. Very close to being beyond the line of scrimmage when he let the ball go, but an outstanding job of Garcia trusting his receivers downfield.
Little toss back to the line of scrimmage to Maddox. Now, if you don't run well, this is where yardage gets a little tough down here.
But don't you get the feel, yes, to that point, but don't you get the feel right now that it looks like South Carolina's playing at home? They've got a better rhythm about them.
I agree.
Georgia's over here, and they're looking around. It's a quiet bench. The vibe's bad right now for the home team.
Quarterback keeper. No signal, they'll mark it short. And there's a flag on the play. So we'll check the marker, Georgia indicating it's against South Carolina. And if it is, that's one of those killer penalties at the 1-yard line.
Good Illegal formation. 5 men in the backfield on the offense. 5 yard penalty. Repeat second down.
That's usually a tackle trying to give himself a little extra room on a passing play, not a running play.
Yeah, you know what? They're going to be really sticklers about that this year. You know, back a little bit right here, maybe. Right guard. T.J. Johnson, maybe he's back just a little bit. He's off those center's numbers.
Jason Barnes, number 4, is in as an extra wide receiver. Saunders, the tight end, is also split out. Garcia for Saunders. Looked like he got away with a push-off as well. Marcus Dalton had good coverage. Garcia tried to float it. And Saunders was doing all those little tricky things he could come up with.
You said it on first and goal down here that unless you got a running game, it gets hard. It doesn't look like there's a game plan. There's a real good strategy of success going on with South Carolina's offensive play calling.
Third and goal. Barnes, a big kid at 6'4". He's to the near side. You want to try a fade to the end zone. They look the other way. Pass underneath. Touchdown. Garcia with a bullet to Gurley. This is what Steve Spurrier has been waiting to see out of Garcia. Big plays and leadership, and he gave it to him on that drive. Lanning for the point after. South Carolina converts the turnover to 7 points, and they lead between the hedges. South Carolina converts the turnover forced by the defense, scores with a short field, leads 7-0.
Mike, they did that last week on that opening series turnover. They scored, and that was it. Nada after that.
We can go home now?
I don't know. Spurrier is now 1-20 when scoring 7 points or less, so I don't know if you like those odds.
Well, I don't think they'll be happy with only 7 today. Brandon Boykin is the deep man. And this crowd is stunned as Georgia went to its premier offensive player, A.J. Green, and he coughed it up on the fumble. And South Carolina turned it into a score. High and over-end kick. Boykin at the goal line. Boykin with blockers in front. 100 yards. Somebody threw a body block and missed him. Somebody else missed a tackle. That looked like DeMarco Jeffrey. Has always had outstanding special teams. They've been known more for blocking kicks, but they'll take this one. 100 on the nose.
So much for not having a vibe here between the hedges. The vibe has arrived. Boykin back, takes off. No wrapping up there by the defenders. DeMarco Jeffrey not there, and then speed. Boykin takes over. The energy, it's here.
100-yarder will do that for you.
And you know what this really does? This puts a real boost in the Georgia team that was lacking, the crowd that wasn't here. And now it challenges Steve Spurrier over there. This is an offense that's got to come out on the road. More than likely, when you see something like this happen, we're not going to have that 3-2 ball game that we were talking about all week.
Yeah,
right? It's over
with.
That's out, the cat's out the bag. There are going to be some points scored.
Once Boykin got by that body block, it was over. And that is the longest kickoff return in school history. some big-time players returning kicks at this school.
That says a lot, doesn't it?
Yes.
And when you say the all-time record at Georgia, you've set a mouthful. Yes, absolutely.
Well, Culliver will go deep. He's already had a big pass breakup and a recovered fumble.
And Culliver's got some pedigree as well. He's 277 yards away from reaching the school record on kick return, so he too knows how to get it down the field.
Lindsey Scott, which is a great name in Georgia history, and Thomas Brown had tied for the longest kick return, 99 yards. But Boykin erases that. Walsh to kick. Culliver is deep. Driven 5 yards deep before, a yard deep this time.
And there won't be 101 on this return.
Now, we said last week when we saw Michigan, these guys are for real. I mean, he recruited some good players, and Rich Rodriguez done it everywhere he's gone.
Especially a signal caller. We said Tate Forcier was for real, and he's absolutely proven that today, outslugging a senior quarterback.
A little delay will only get a couple. Giles, 5'11", 183 pounds out of Tampa, Florida, had 5 carries a week ago. He is a game breaker. He's one of those guys that every time he touches it, he can take it to the house.
Well, in the spring game, he had 12 carries for 114 yards. He does have that burst. And you need a burst against a Georgia, real quick defensive front. You need to run past the arm tacklers.
They contend nobody is going to be able to run against them. Nobody. Go to the fullback on the little check down, and Patrick DeMarco, who caught one pass a week ago, picks up 15 on this one. Heather Cox, what do you have?
Well, Mike, after the lackluster win over NC State, Steve Spurrier told me he blamed himself, saying, "I didn't have a great coaching night," and he vowed to be much more involved in play calling this week. He said he was much too conservative a week ago, but he admitted with such a good defense, there's certainly a tendency to be too safe, to not do anything stupid to get the turnover, saying it's a fine line. You've got to try to call your plays and still be aggressive. Guy's certainly challenging himself tonight.
And Heather, you know it just eats at him when he's playing it conservative. Perfect throw that time by Garcia, has the first down. Jason Barnes makes his first catch. He had 27 a year ago as a redshirt freshman. Garcia threw that one flat-footed, still got it right on the number.
All right, now so what we're seeing here is the South Carolina offense taking advantage of some play action and drop back, middle of the field. Georgia trying to fire zone and drop out of the middle to cover and take away that middle throw, and not successful.
Garcia already looks more comfortable than he did last week. Got a man wide open, end zone, touchdown, caught by Gurley. But a flag is down back at the 35-yard line.
Ineligible receiver downfield on the offense. Number 88, he was covered up as a tight end. That's a 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Perfect pass. He just couldn't throw it any better. Garcia, short set. The out is incomplete. Intended that for another game breaker. Alshon Jeffrey, who originally committed to Southern California, and they kept him here.
South Carolina's football team has had a history over the last few years of really starting strong with their season and their record, and the second half falling apart. The team's number one gap goal this year was to finish games. When you visit with their players, Mo Brown said, "We want to finish football games, play an entire 60 minutes the entire season."
Second and 15. Garcia takes off. They'll whistle the play down.
Defense. Timeout Georgia. That's their first timeout.
Willie Martinez group called timeout, so there was no play. It will be second and long for South Carolina when we come back. We're tied at 7 first quarter. That's Hurdy Field. Field, the original field where they played football for Georgia, hosted the first game in 1892, turned into a parking lot, but then converted back to green space in 1999. And that's the chapel bell, which is rung after every Georgia victory.
Well, speaking of somebody wanting to get their bell rung, I'm sure Steve Spurrier would like to borrow that bell. Here's the problem here. Tight end Willie Saunders, he's covered up. Gurley's right there. He's got to drop back off the line of scrimmage. And when I was mentioning earlier about Mo Brown and his teammates saying we want to finish strong and play an entire 60 minutes, play the season, that's part of it. Playing the full game, smart, intelligent football. Line up properly.
So Gurley was the guy who made the mistake. And his touchdown is taken away from his club. Garcia will go to the shotgun. Directing traffic, puts Giles on his right. Pressure coming. Just throws this one up for grabs, and Giles nearly made the catch. Flags are down. That's going to be interference. Marcus Washington, a defensive end, converted to linebacker this week because of an injury, was back there in coverage.
Pass interference, number 3 on the defense, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
We're calling on Brian Evans.
Now, the thing that strikes me on this play as much as the interference call is the fact that Steven Garcia checked at the line of scrimmage. He got them in this play to begin with. He didn't do a lot of obelizing and checking off last week, and Spurrier said he would do that more this week. So that right there struck me. And number 2, the defense not really being aware and doing a good job on their pass defense and coverage.
They called the penalty on Evans. It was obviously not him. It was Washington 44 who was face guarding Garcia. Got as much out of it as he could. The ball came loose. They're going to say he was down before it did. No fumble at the 24. And Darryl Gamble, the middle linebacker, was the guy who took him down and knocked it away. Garcia has to do a better job than that, but he ran well.
No question, it's in Garcia's mind to look down the field and then to take off. Is the knee down yet? Are the ball's coming out before that knee is on the ground? This call will be challenged. Really see it well from the other angle.
The change in the rule this year, if it's recovered immediately, they can look at it.
This is absolutely a fumble.
And one of the South Carolina players is injured. And it may be the starting left tackle, Jerriel King.
During the play, there was an illegal shot block for 81 on the offense. That previous play is under further review. After review, the ball was fumbled. It was recovered by South Carolina. We will inform the shot block from the end of the run. So it's a 15-yard penalty, and we'll repeat the down.
Which begs the question, if it was recovered by South Carolina, why did we review it?
Where the ball was recovered, they'll go back to from the infraction and back them up.
Let me repeat my question. If South Carolina recovered the ball, why did they review it? Because it changes nothing. That's a new one. The rule is different, but the idea that it's not going anywhere, is it? But they move them back on the penalty. And South Carolina will try to run the ball with Brian Maddox. He picks up about 5.
Well, we've already seen more offense than I was expecting to see. I really expected a lot of 3 and outs in this ballgame. So the confidence from the offense, particularly South Carolina, is high right now. They feel good about themselves. They've taken advantage of the underneath passing zones that Georgia's got. Georgia's defenders have to see better the routes. They've got to do a better job of recognition from receivers.
Second and long. Garcia has DeMarco open to the flat and hits him. And that looks like the defender grabbed the helmet. Vance Cuff, and you cannot grab any part of the helmet. And Cuff immediately shakes his head like, I made a mistake. It's a good decision by Garcia. He's seeing the field well.
Personal foul, face mask, number 25 on the defense. That penalty will be enforced half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
So a real exchange of huge penalties.
And you know, Mike, this was a play right after I'd made the statement. It supports what I'm talking about. Out in the flat, the corner doesn't go out. He sees clearly the receiver running across in his face to the flat, his responsibility, and he leaves him open over there. He's tardy to the play.
And you don't have to grab the face mask. It's any part of that helmet, and it's the same thing. Now South Carolina in the red zone again. First and 10 at the 13 for Garcia. Little fade for the end zone. Gurley overthrown this team. This time covered very well by Boykin. But that is a physical mismatch. Boykin at 5'10", Gurley at 6'5".
Well, don't you see, though, that Spurrier's got confidence in Garcia? He's
absolutely
putting the ball up, throwing it down there. Georgia's excellent against the run, and they're up tight and going to challenge the running game. I'm impressed with Steve Spurrier. Call him. Give him the ball. Put it in his hands. Let him develop.
Garcia changing the play. Blitz coming. Garcia underneath. That's going to be an easy touchdown for Maddox. He was wide open. And you may have seen the emergence of a South Carolina quarterback tonight.
Garcia checked, as you said, Mike, which was another real indication that he understands what the defense is doing. It got him in the right play for the running back out of the backfield to slide underneath and get to the flat for the touchdown.
Garcia now 8 out of 12, 91 yards and 2 touchdowns in the first quarter on the road at Georgia. Not bad at all. South Carolina with a couple of touchdowns, and they lead number 21, Georgia, 14-7. Maddox wide open in the flat. Garcia hit him for the touchdown. How about this? This is a pretty good play.
Yeah, Brian Maddox. There's the check at the line of scrimmage. Brian Gamble, linebacker, runs right past him. There's no pickup on the outside. Bottom of your screen, bottom right. Maddox by himself. And this is a result of Steven Garcia getting the team in the right call.
Brandon Smith is deep to receive. Makes you wonder what happened to Brandon Boykin. Last time he touched it, he went 100 yards. Georgia has run two plays on offense. They have 30 seconds of possession in the first quarter.
And I don't think they're really intending to rest Joe Cox's arm that much.
No. Smith, 5 yards deep, and he'll bring it off. Fumble the football. Now they'll unpile. South Carolina says they've got it. Smith made a horrible decision to come out 5 yards deep. Both teams still contending. They have it, and South Carolina does. Holy cow, fireworks galore.
Brandon Smith is a true freshman. In a high-impact game like this, an outstanding athlete that's 5 yards deep, first of all, that's a problem coming out. and he's trying to adjust the football in his hands. He's a defensive back. He's a quarterback. He's a running. He's a little of this, a little of that. He just had a slick forward grip on the football.
And Tony Strother unloaded on him and then got the football.
Well, you know,
monster
what?
Break for South Carolina.
And you know what else, Mike? Georgia still only has two offensive plays.
Yes, they do. Garcia. Floats it for the end zone and floats it too far for Mo Brown. Boy, initially he had Max wide open again.
When I hear those numbers, 21 snaps to two for your offense, that's going to tire out this Georgia defense. It's very humid down here on the field. And so you've got a Georgia defense that's really fast. They play hard. No question, their stinger is going to be a little less.
Two turnovers have really hurt. One after a completed pass. One on the kickoff that we just saw. And Garcia has three wide receivers to the far side. Looks that way, goes on the quarterback draw. Garcia to the three.
Garcia off the clearing.
Boykin covered him up.
Another outstanding call. This really is like a wildcat formation if you think about it. And you've got a tailback that's going to lead over for you. Quarterback draw, block down, kick out. Inside with your blocker, your tailback. Your quarterback running the football. Smart call again by Stephen Garcia.
South Carolina wants a timeout with 5:16 to go in the first quarter. We have a timeout between the hedges. It's been all South Carolina so far. This has been one of the oddest 14-7 games we've ever seen. Georgia's run two plays. Their only offense came on a 100-yard kick return, the longest in school history. Outside of that, they have done absolutely nothing except shoot themselves in the foot. And here comes South Carolina. Maddox, the tailback. Garcia on the roll. Throws and it's tipped. Intended for the fullback who was open. Nice play by DeMarcus Dobbs, number 58. He got the hand up, or that was a complete pass and could have gone for a touchdown. Now here comes the field goal team.
And the fullback went the wrong way, really. I mean, he's in the right direction, but he looks up the field instead of going to the pylon. Fullback has to look over his right shoulder. Watch how he gets directed. Look to your right shoulder so that you give a different angle for that pass. Somewhere on the outside, DeMarco should have gone to the pylon.
This will be a 21-yard field goal attempt by Spencer Lanning, who is the punter who is taking over the place-kicking duties this year. They botched a couple last week, one on a bad snap, one on a bad kick, but not this time. And South Carolina extends its lead to 17-7. Georgia will get the football trailing 17-7, and they have put Brandon Boykin back as their deep man after the fumble by Brandon Smith. Boykin, who returned a previous kick, went 100 yards with it. We just have to wonder what may have been wrong with him that would get you Brandon Smith back there after you run it back 100 yards.
Fatigue.
Boykin a yard deep.
First one went 100. How about 101?
A saving tackle by Devontae Holloman. 48-yard return this time.
Boykin gets a lot of the love and attention because he's carrying the football, but his blocking up front is outstanding. Or the lack of coverage ability is more from South Carolina. Any way you look at it, you've now had really five possessions for Georgia's football team in this game. You know, when you talk about kick returns and snaps, just not a lot of chances.
This will be Georgia's third play from scrimmage. Third.
Cox to throw. Has time.
throws in the flat, caught by Chappis, the fullback. And he's gobbled up by Culliver after a gain of about four.
To say that you really, you know, time of possession and your defense is tired, to say this is an important drive for Georgia is an understatement. But man, this right here, that's just, how many games have we ever done where you've got 23-3 to start a game?
None.
I don't know of one.
Joe Cox was warming up on the sidelines during the last South Carolina offensive series because it had been so long after pregame warmups. Big stick, but bouncing off of it is Richard Samuel. Their concern about Samuel is that he had only gotten the yardage that the offensive line had given him. He hadn't broken any tackles. That time, Darian Stewart didn't wrap him up.
Well, he's running behind his pads, Mike. When a running back gets that shoulder and that face mask down and you keep the defender off your legs and you keep your legs driving, you're going to establish a lot more with the yards after initial contact.
Sometimes tacklers try to go in there and blow somebody up rather than making a solid tackle. Cox with time. Out in the flat again is tailback Samuel. And he's down to the 20. Gain of 17.
That's your senior. That's your senior patience. That's Joe Cox not trying to push something down the middle. He feels a little momentum going with his team. Not necessarily needing a home run ball right now as much as he does. His team needs snaps. Take it underneath. Let your players make some plays.
Well, those are the two guys, Cox and Samuel, who replaced Matthew Stafford and Noshon Moreno. That's a lot of offense to make up for. Israel Troop number 28 is in as a wide receiver. He's on the outside. Cox over the middle. They tried to set up a middle screen and they missed Tavares King. He was open and had people in front of him.
Very smart call there by Georgia, taking advantage of that aggressive speed up front of South Carolina. There's some really talented football players on this South Carolina defense. They run hard, they pursue the football, and they're fresh right now.
Yeah, they should be. Second and 10 for Cox. Samuel is the deep man in the eye, and he'll get the carry. Boy, running hard tonight, just lowering that pad level and driving for it. You hear that crunch.
I think the memo made it to his locker. Samuel read the memo that said yak, and he's delivering. That's a lot of courage there for the staff to make that call out of I formation. It's us against you. Listen to this pop.
Big time, tough run. Third and four. Three wide receivers and Samuel for Joe Cox. Cox over the middle, batted away, almost intercepted, and now the flag is down. Stephon Gilmore got a hand on it. And Shaq Wilson, the new middle linebacker, was juggling it, will check the penalty. Wilcox is the kid who saved last week's game for South Carolina.
Pass interference, number 16 on the defense. That penalty will be enforced by the foul, first and goal.
That's Shaq Wilson, the middle linebacker, called for interference, something that obviously upset Steve Spurrier. And this will put the ball inside the five.
Yeah, I'm not sure that they got the call right on that. I believe it was number five, Stephon Gilmore. I'm not even sure Shaq Wilson's in the area. Hands on him, he's holding him. Yeah, that has nothing to do with Shaq Wilson. That's all on the freshman, the true freshman, Gilmore.
Yeah, Shaq Wilson was the guy that came up with the ball almost. Samuel, the deep man in the eye. First and goal, Samuel gets the carry to the one. Cut down by Culliver, number 17, who got him at the ankles, but he reached the 1 yard line.
If Culliver had not gone for the low or part of the legs, there's no way he stops him. And that's from a former wide receiver. Culliver used to play wide out, so maybe he just didn't want to get in there and get high.
Well, 190 against 216. Samuels, touchdown. He dragged Alonzo Winfield, the linebacker, across the goal line. When Georgia gets more than two offensive plays, they do okay.
How about that? Unique concept.
Walsh with a point after. And the Bulldogs have cut it to three.
Really impressed with this Georgia offensive line. They've had to juggle and move folks around. They come out in this drive here, and they play smash-mouth football right in the mustache of that South Carolina defense, and Samuel brought it, brought the wood.
Well, they wanted him to get yards after contact, and on that drive, he did. 19 yards after he was first hit.
Raise your hand if you thought that the score would be 17-14 at the end of the game.
My hand's not up.
I'm in my pockets.
Been exciting between the hedges so far. 1:56 to go in the first quarter, and South Carolina taking advantage of turnovers. Leads number 21 Georgia by a 17-14 count. Glad you could join us tonight for some great SEC football on ESPN. This rivalry has always produced close games and normally has produced low scoring games. We have an exception tonight. Culliver deep to receive. Waiting at his six this time for the kicker, Blair Walsh. Booms this one. 8 yards deep, and Culliver will keep it here. He is a terrific quarterback. Garcia throws to Gurley, who takes it down for 32.
You know, when I talk about route recognition and watching defenses when I travel around and seeing coaches and how they teach their defenders to read the route and understand what's going on. The play action pass tonight we knew was a critical part of the game plan. Garcia back to throw. Look here at this void. There's nobody behind the linebacker. And I know that they're putting some pressure, but they're not hugging up to the receivers who are down in the zones.
First and 10 from the 32. There's a little option play, and they give it to Giles. That's Garcia reading and deciding whether to hand it off or keep it.
Heather, down on that sideline, did the Georgia players kind of wake up after that last series?
Absolutely. There's a lot more fire, a lot more motivation down here. It was very quiet early in the first quarter. That offense actually looked bored. They'd hardly been on the field. Everybody's stunned at the amount of scoring that's taken place, and this team certainly looking more inspired, more motivated. A little pop in their step down here.
17-14, under a minute to go, first quarter. Garcia on the keeper this time. Well, he doesn't look all that quick. He does not look like your typical option quarterback, but he certainly gets a lot of yards when he runs. 16 on this one, but there's a flag down.
Holding, number 72 on the offense. 10 yards penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat second down.
To right tackle, Quentin Richardson. So a big run comes back.
Yeah, it does come back, but yet it exposes a weakness, another weakness in that Georgia defense. I mean, when you get to the corner like that on a zone quarterback read, you got a problem. Now you defensively, Willie Martinez, the defensive coordinator, he's sitting up there thinking, okay, I got to get somebody out there. I got to be prepared for this.
South Carolina's been hit with 5 penalties in the opening quarter. Now they face the second and 12 as they're pushed back to the 30-yard line. And Georgia may have jumped. Looked like Jeff Owens, the big left tackle. Got an early start. Let's see if he was drawn off.
Chance to visit with Owens yesterday. He's coming back from an 08 injury. Glad to be back on the field. Got a lot of family that have driven up, right? So
that's right.
I know he didn't want to have 95 called out like that.
No. They made the trek from Sunrise, Florida. Garcia now dumps it over the middle to Giles. Can't get away with a tackle by Ronnie Curran. He had 115 stops a week ago. That led the Southeastern Conference. And that is the end of the first quarter. And what a quarter it was. 17-14. South Carolina over Georgia. It's the SEC on ESPN. SEC on ESPN. Ready to start the second quarter in Athens, Georgia. 92,000 plus for the Southeastern Conference opener for both South Carolina comes in after beating NC State a week ago. Georgia lost on the road at Oklahoma State, a team that was itself upset today by Houston. Third and seven facing South Carolina. And it's going to be an offsides. DeMarcus Dobbs jumped early. That would be the second offsides in this sequence against Georgia. Well, they do point their fingers at each other a lot, don't they?
For the staff, offsides, number 58 on the defense, in the neutral zone, causing the offense to react. 5 yard penalty.
Especially the guy who did the wrong deal, right?
Yes.
When you look at Steven Garcia in the first quarter, 10 out of 16, an outstanding start for the young man. And we're charting underneath passes less than 15 yards. Look at that, 4 of 7, 1 of 2 in the middle, 5 of 6, only one down the field. We had one touchdown that was called back that was deep for him. So we're going to chart where the throws are going tonight for Steven Garcia, but he's taking advantage of the play action and the underneath passing zones that Georgia's not covering.
Those two penalties have given the option of run or throw, and that is right through the arms of Jason Barnes. Tried to catch it with his body instead of his hands, and it was a perfect throw by Garcia.
Nothing you can say there about Garcia on this one. Barnes has got to finish this play off. This is part of that consistency in finishing plays, almost like he ducked his head expecting to get hit from a linebacker coming inside.
Well, the old saw is you're going to get hit anyway. You might as well catch it.
Yeah. You know, it sounds theoretically great from a dad to his kid or from a coach to a kid's player. But when you're that player in that helmet, it doesn't work sometimes.
Amen. Spencer Lanning will kick to Logan Gray. Makes a fair catch to the 21-yard line. 14:50 to go first half. 38-yard kick. No return. It's a three-point game. 17-14, South Carolina on top here in the second quarter. This Georgia offense lost its two biggest weapons from a year ago to the NFL. Matthew Stafford starred his entire college career at Georgia. He set Bulldog records, 25 touchdown passes last year, almost 3,500 yards passing, the second highest in school history. He was the first pick in the NFL draft. The start for the Lions tomorrow. Last year, Noshon Marino is a redshirt freshman. He ran for over 1,400 yards, 15 touchdowns. He was the 12th overall pick by the Broncos.
So do you think, you just mentioned all that, do you think the Georgia fans are expecting anything less than another 10-win season?
Of course not. They're fans, aren't they?
Right. That's why they're so good.
Cox, good protection. And what a catch. A.J. Green who led the Southeastern Conference a year ago in yardage, snatched that one out of the sky for 23.
First and foremost, you've got to say props to the wide receivers for putting their feet in the ground and running to where they're supposed to do it. A.J. Green, look at that left foot in the ground, in between. And how about the touch on the pass from Joe Cox? That shoulder was just strong enough to make that throw.
You look for that 6'4 wide receiver. He jumps and gets up like he's 6'9.
Substitution violation, under offense, breaking the huddle with 12 men. 5-yard penalty, first down.
That'll make it first and 15 after the completion. The play stands.
You heard me say put your foot in the ground. I watch a lot of wide receivers in the country now in film study. They're not. They're running vanilla routes.
Sort of glide.
They're just running to an area. But when you put that foot in the ground, you're putting pressure on the hips of a defender, trying to make him turn so that when you time it right and get to your area, the ball's there with you.
Quarterback likes to see those sharp cuts, too. And it's an end around. Smith. What great speed. See ya. Put him down for 61 yards. Brandon Smith, who's the defensive back, plays on every special team and a guy they want to touch the football.
How about Joe Cox coming around after that and making a block on the outside? Brandon Smith making up for the fumbled kickoff return earlier. Blazing speed.
Kid is special out of Atlanta, Georgia. Runs a 4.28 40.
Ran a 4.1 that time, Mike.
And Georgia has the lead for the first time here at home.
Sometimes your name will work for you, even if you're not tough. Okay.
Now, how did that air respond?
Absolutely. The air was sucked completely off that South Carolina bench when Smith flew by. They've got to pump some back over there now.
Four-man rush against Garcia. Intercepted. Brandon Boykin with a tremendous block. Coming down.
Just before the snap, I almost said, Mike, the way they get the air back on their sidelines is to be patient and throw the ball underneath and not force anything. The ball should have gone underneath and short to his receiver. Instead, he tries to throw it, and an outstanding job of the corner jumping back, Boykin, and covering up the out ball.
He landed on the ball, may have knocked the wind out from under him, but he held on. So Boykins had a 100-yard kickoff return, a 48-yard kickoff return, and a pick. Now Georgia back in business. Samuel, the deep man in the eye. Orson, Charles' tight end, who had two big catches a week ago. This one's for 20. What defense?
Coach Mark Rick said, look, our team just needs a big play or two to get momentum established for the 2009 season. It has started. It is here. Orson Charles got lost in the middle of that South Carolina defense, but Joe Cox, sore shoulder and all, 9 pounds lighter, sick from the flu. He found him.
Orson Charles, another high school All-American recruited out of Tampa, Florida, showing his style. 21-17, Georgia. come to Athens, you got to check out Weaver D's Soul Food since 1986. Like that. Automatic.
Little hum in the hedges, between the hedges right now.
38 points already, and that ties the most we've had in the series. This was supposed to be a battle between two big-time defenses. Somebody forgot to tell the offenses. Cox runs out of trouble and throws it away. Good play by Joe Cox. A young man who wants to be a coach when his playing days are over, a kid who loves the University of Georgia. He could have transferred and gone a lot of places and been a starting quarterback when Matthew Stafford claimed the job as his. Of course, Stafford went on to be the number one draft choice the entire NFL. But he said he just loved it here too much.
Learned a lot from Matthew, didn't he?
Yes,
just watching, observing.
Thomas, the new tailback, and he pounds inside the 10. They need to reach the 4 and for a first down, and there's a flag down.
Chop block, number 79 on the offense, 15-yard penalty from the spot of the pound. He's second down.
Justin Anderson has been elevated to right guard with a chop block. Let's check in with the studio. Here's Wendy.
Mike, thank you. The collision in Columbus underway, and the Trojans wasting little time. USC going for it, fourth and goal. Stephon Johnson on the carry. The Trojans strike first, 7-0 USC.
Well, Pete Carroll knows what he has. We were out there last year. I think he had 6 All-American tailbacks in the roster. All-Americans.
You got to have a lot of courage and confidence in yourself if you decide to play running back out of high school at USC. And they did that early in the first quarter.
Cox on second and a mile now. Completes this one out in the flat. That'll be a minimal gain as Darian Stewart comes up and makes the tackle on Tavares King.
You know, you mentioned Matthew Stafford and all that talent. Here's Mike Vogel, the offensive coordinator, who's had to really bring along Joe Cox and be prepared to use his senior quarterback, knowing that Stafford wasn't going to be there. But he told, like, just the confidence, having a package for Brandon Smith, for example, the reverse, the touchdown, really putting plays in for his quarterback, Joe Cox, to be successful.
Third and 16 here. That offensive line's done a nice job protecting him, too. South Carolina with that big pass rush. Haven't gotten there until now, and that should be intentional grounding on Cox as he threw it away. There was nobody there. Eric Norwood, and just as soon as we compliment the offensive line, Norwood beats them on a blitz. Ain't that the way it is?
Intentional grounding, number 14 on the offense. Lost him down at the spot of the foul.
And that's a big penalty because it's the loss of down and the yardage.
Now, Eric Norwood, number 40, in our impact players, and we spoke about him earlier in the ballgame. He is one of the greatest playmakers in college football on defense. He's always creating opportunities for his unit.
Now, Blair Walsh, this is going to be close to 50 yards. He made a 53-yarder a week ago. So he's got the leg. Crushes that. Holy cow, that had a spare 8 or 9 on it.
When you've got a kicker like that, can hit from that range, it certainly makes up for a little intentional grounding and a bad job of blocking. 53 yards last week, as you said, Mike. He's got a strong leg, a lot of confidence now coming out of that football game. Mark Ritten not afraid to dial it up and give him a chance.
Looks like anything under 60, he's got a legitimate shot. Checking with Heather Cox. Heather.
Well, guys, during that last drive, you were talking about Matt Stafford. I had a chance to talk to Joe Cox yesterday about what he learned from Matt. And he said, I learned so much backing him up. Things about adversity, game management, how to be poised under pressure. And the two remain close. In fact, Matt Stafford sent
week before the Oklahoma State game, which Joe said meant the world to him, considering he's just a tad bit busy preparing for his first NFL start. Detroit opens at New Orleans tomorrow, and Joe Cox really trying to channel Matt Stafford right now, guys.
You know, that's pretty tough. You're Matthew Stafford, your reward for being such a brilliant quarterback is to go to a team that was winless a year ago.
Yikes. But he's sleeping on a pillow that's got Benjamin Franklin stuffed in it.
Yeah, a lot of them.
You think he's buying when he comes back to campus for Joe Cox?
Yeah, the cheeseburgers are on him.
Absolutely.
24-17 Georgia. Culliver from the three this time. Eating up the 21. My guy Brett hurt a year ago. It affected his play with the Jets. He should be healthy now after the surgery. I think he's going to have a heck of a year in Minnesota.
Tom Landry made the comment many years ago that I listened to. He said, you know, great players don't lose the ability. They lose the ability to do it week in and week out. You don't have legs, so what will the only?
South Carolina tries to go with the running play, and Brandon Wheeling says,
Now, I pull it for Brett Favre because I'm a fan of his.
Me
well.
Too.
I admire him a lot. Now, here you go. You've got South Carolina back out. They've got to get momentum back on their sideline. And as we said at the end of the last series, when he threw the interception, Garcia has to manage the game and get back to being confident throwing the ball underneath again.
Brandon Smith. He of the reverse and the touchdown is in as an extra defensive back for Georgia. He is number one. Second and 12 for South Carolina. Garcia underneath. Complete out to the 24 to Mo Brown.
I mean, not even the same body language from Garcia when he throws the football.
You're absolutely right.
You know, you just very cautious body when this is two throws in a row now that he has done this. Not stepping up with authority and throwing it, just kind of hoping it gets there. Not like he was earlier.
Third and long. See if Willie Martinez dials up anything for his defense. Right now they're trying to move players, as is the offense. Garcia under pressure has to throw it away, look for Maddox, but DeMarcus Dobbs was all over.
Just watching Georgia's back seven, recognizing routes now, figuring out what South Carolina's receivers are doing, keeping them in front of them, and then hugging them. No options, no place for Garcia to go to.
It looks like Georgia's become much more aggressive. South Carolina's become much more tentative.
Yeah, they changed jerseys, didn't they? Early in the game, it was the other way around.
Prince Miller is deep. Spencer landing the punt. Well, still a ton of time to go here in the first half. 10:51. That first quarter took an hour and 5 minutes, and it's a fake, and Lanning easily runs for the first down. Nobody checked him on that side. He went for 11. Well, Georgia knew the Steve Spurrier always has a couple of tricks in the bag, and he pulled one out right there.
How about Beamer? Little Beamer ball going on in South Carolina. Good job, Shane. Look at the right side. This has to be an automatic because you've got leverage. You've got leverage. If you get that look, Beamer said code for it. It's an automatic. No question about it. An outstanding job of call and preparation during the week for your special teams.
And that's Shane Beamer, the son of Frank. And, of course, we know Virginia Tech has been so famous for its special teams and trick plays. Wesley Saunders made that catch. And Shane Beamer is also the recruiting coordinator. And this is the best recruiting class I think they've had since Steve Spurrier's been in South Carolina. They have some great kids on this team. Trying to run the hurry up here.
Well, he's done a great job. Spurrier said even last year when they fell off at the end and had a terrible finish, they didn't lose one recruit. Everybody stayed committed
to
him.
Georgia, that's their second timeout. Timeout was before the flag.
Georgia calls a timeout on defense with 10:18 to go. Boy, if you call a trick play and it works like that, that'll get the sideline up in a hurry. Welcome back to the SEC on ESPN. We are between the hedges in Athens, or under the arch, according to that shot. They have just announced the score, Houston, Oklahoma State, to the crowd, and there was stunned silence that the team that beat them a week ago had been beaten up by Houston. South Carolina in Georgia territory, first down. Blitz coming. They pick it up, and Garcia throws underneath to Mo Brown, makes the catch the 38-yard line.
That game at the half, and Mississippi State 21-17, Auburn on top.
Alabama was leading Florida International by 6 at the half.
So what are you saying?
Jeez.
Is that what it is right now at halftime?
The Florida Atlantic?
It wasn't Florida, Florida State, or Miami, so no, that means something, right?
Yes, it does. Third and 3. They look to the sideline to get the call after they get the formation that they want on defense. 3-man rush. Garcia over the middle. Saunders first down to the 29-yard line. Wesley Saunders, a big target. 6'5", 280, sort of blocks out the lights when he goes over the middle.
And I never played linebacker, but watch it. Stop right here. You see how there's a great void from Rennie Curran to the other outside? You got to hug him up in man.
Well, how many plays have we had blown dead tonight?
Before the snap, false start. Number 72 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Remains first down.
Quentin Richardson and Steve Spurrier really upset about the call.
Okay, now, based on body language, intensity level, if we had a thermometer on that body right now, you'd see him way up high. He didn't get to that level last Thursday night against NC State.
Now you could light a cigar on his forehead right now.
Pass the ashtray.
First and 15. Garcia. He threw it to one side. Mo Brown turned the other way. The ball went behind. A lot of pride in that program. I think they're getting a little tired of being shoved around, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
Garcia checking to see what they want. He's got 4 wide receivers, including his tight end split up. Maddox is in there as a blocking back. Good throw, good catch, and then he couldn't hold it. Gurley dropped that one, and Garcia got it in there. That would have been a first down or very close to it.
We've had a couple of times now Gurley has dropped some balls. Again, just not finishing plays for Garcia.
And he made the big mistake on the play he did make, which would have been a touchdown, as he covered up the tight end. Now it's 3rd and 15. They need to pick up a little bit to get in field goal range. Georgia comes with a 4-man rush. Garcia pressured, got it to the 22-yard line. And that's D.L. Moore with his first catch of the entire season. And it will bring up a 4th down and give him a much better shot at a field goal try.
Really great strides and improvement from Steven Garcia versus last week. You see, not breaking the pocket and taking off and running, finding his receiver.
They are at least going to fake going for it. And that's what it looks like they're doing. Fake going for it. Now they'll call time and talk it over. the conservative play would be to send out the field goal unit and cut into the lead. But you never know. We've already had a fake punt. Don't go away. Number 17, Georgia on top of South Carolina. We check in with Heather Cox.
Georgia defense trying to stop South Carolina without two of its starters. Brandon Boykin, who's had a great first half, back in the locker room with cramps, and defensive end Rodney Battle out with a left knee injury. It looks serious. Ice on that left knee. Very emotional. Mark Richtover hugging him during that timeout, guys.
Thanks, Heather. It's not a good time to have cramps. Once they start, they're tough to get rid of. It's not even halftime. Lanning will try from 39 yards. Splits the uprights, and it's 24-20. In the last six games with Georgia, neither South Carolina nor the Bulldogs had scored over 20 points. Right now it's 24-20. We got 8:21 to go in the first half.
Mark Richt was looking for big plays, momentum changers, attitude adjusters, ways to get the 2009 season going, and he certainly got that tonight. Early in the ball game, the kickoff return, Brandon Boykin, 100 yards, the longest in school history. They follow that up with a little trickeration, the reverse to the true freshman, Brandon Smith. He blows doors on South Carolina's defense, makes them look slow. And then Boykin again comes back on defense with a nice turnover and an interception over in the flat, taking advantage of a poor decision by Stephen Garcia.
Well, there have been some big plays in this first half. This game started at what, 7:05? We got 16-9 right now?
My body's now, I'm going to be off a little bit here. I'm going to have something to eat because I fed it and it was thinking 3 hours and 15 minutes.
Well, tell it to think again.
It will after it gets something to eat in a minute.
Brandon Smith is deep. Boykin in the locker room, as Heather pointed out, getting the IV. So Smith, who tried to bring one out 5 yards deep and fumbled, led to a South Carolina turnover. Here's a poop punt. And a fair catch by one of the upmen at the 30-yard line. Will start the offense from the 32-yard line. Thomas, his running back, to the 35, where Josh Dickerson, a transfer from Georgia Military, makes the tackle. A young man who they think has a great deal of potential, but he was hurt and missed the spring.
Still learning. He's got some learning to go. Elliott, their defensive coordinator, is one of those guys that just, he teaches well, but it takes time for them all to learn together how to be together.
They lost a lot of people off this ball club to the NFL. Comes the blitz, Norwood. Out in the flat again, a short gains to Tavares King, and Culliver upended.
You know, following up with Ellis Johnson, their defensive coordinator, one of the things that he's benefited from this year defensively is the fact that Spurrier wanted to work so much more in practice with the running game. So it's helped his tackling on defense. It used to get away from that a little bit, but it's definitely showing they're a better tackling team most of the time.
Michael Moore splits out to the near side, two wide receivers on the inside. Cox bobbled the snap from center, may not have had a real good grip on it, and hurried it and missed the pass to the near side.
It almost looked like, Mike, that the snap count in Cox's head didn't match the center's head.
Yeah.
Right? Very, very lucky right there.
And the center's going to win every time.
Ready or not, here she comes.
And that's what they're talking over right now. Joe Cox talking to Ben Jones. I don't want to argue with Ben Jones.
Well, and not with that look in his eyes.
No.
Like that.
Akeem Augusti is deep for Drew Butler's kick, the first punt of the night for Georgia. He leads the nation with a 57-yard average after 1 week. That one was a little shorter, and Augusti with a couple of nice. Nice move, nearly broken. Brought down at the 30-yard line. Four-yard dancing return, a 37-yard punt. And now for tonight's Aflac trivia question. Which two Heisman winners met in the 1980 matchup between these two schools? Now that is a relatively easy question. Just think back. Of course, if you're 22 years old, you're out of luck. South Carolina with plenty of time left. They start just shy of the 30. Low snap for Garcia. Play action keeps it. Boy, you'd like to see him not run nearly as upright as he does. Somebody's going to unload on this guy somewhere.
Okay, remember now, Garcia ran this earlier, and there was a penalty, and it came back. So now you've got to make the adjustment defensively, and they didn't. Look at the outside. You've got to be disciplined here. If he comes inside, the ball's going around. Where's your linebacker spilling to the outside? Wasn't there. Way too much. No responsibility on the outside. Linebacker 51's got to get out there. Akeem Dent got to see it.
Again, Garcia has his key. If that defensive end comes inside, he keeps it. And there's the little tailback, Jarvis Giles again, and Marcus Doughton, number 38, made the tackle.
Well, if you were buying stock in South Carolina, you would definitely see the trend tonight is against the norm, against the average. Last week, 42 rushes, 22 passes. They turned that around a little bit tonight, right? So you're scratching your head as a defensive coordinator saying, okay, got to make the adjustment at halftime and defend the pass a little bit more.
Well, Steve hasn't thrown that visor, but he's ripped it off a couple of times. Second and seven. Giles lowers his shoulder and pounds into a Akeem Dent. Gets to the 47-yard line. They have to reach the 43 for a first down. Boy, both offenses have acquitted themselves beautifully tonight. Crowd coming to its feet here in Athens, urging the defense on. They need a stop here. Garcia with time. That's Saunders, the big tight end. £280 on a 6'5 frame. And a lot of these guys use kind of basketball skills, like a power forward. You go down, you post up, and you wait for the ball.
And this is the exact play that they ran just a while ago for the same result, right? Third and short. You got a big tight end receiver set between the two linebackers that are pinching you. That's pitch and catch. That's easy.
And you do not go through a guy at 6'5", 280. You got to go around him. It's a lot to go around. Giles, nice move. Another nice move. Giles, sideline, horse collar to D8. And a flag. Jarvis Giles made two beautiful moves.
It's amazing what speed will make a defender look like. And Akeem Dent will tell you that right now.
Made him look bad, didn't he?
Oh, my goodness, several of them.
Now, the question is that around the neck? Or did it grab part of the helmet? It just looked like he had him around the neck at first blush. And there's nothing wrong with that. At least as far as the rule book is concerned.
After the play, personal foul, number 9 on the defense. That penalty will be half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
That's on Rashad Jones, the junior, the Thorpe Award candidate. Watch the moves of Giles. This is beautiful.
Well, once again, you've got the underneath passing game really working for South Carolina and against Georgia's defense. Tackle around the head there by Rashad Jones. That's a penalty and a nice call.
No wonder they were so thrilled to get Giles. They can get another first down at the 2. Maddox on the delay for about the 8-yard line. Akeem Dent with another tackle.
We just showed you the play selection, the number of runs versus passes. The passing game really opening up this South Carolina offense, and it's all happening underneath. Only one ball beyond 15 yards completed tonight. Everything else has been underneath. Defensive coordinator there, Willie Martinez. He'll make that adjustment. He'll see it. He'll talk about it, talk about the routes that are being run against him. But he's 10 yards or less. He's got to cover him up.
Second and 7. Garcia for the end zone, incomplete, intended for Gurley. He was double covered. Stops the clock with 3:15 to go in the half.
A lot of hands on the hips on that Georgia defense right now. Trying to find some extra wind to come blowing through the tunnel.
Well, it looks like Garcia has his rhythm back. Keep an eye on Saunders. He's on the right side of the line. Big target. Garcia. Just inside the 5. They have to get just inside the 2 for a first down. And here comes the field goal team. They'll settle for a 3-point attempt, which would cut the lead to 1.
I know this is frustrating and disappointing for Steve Spurrier because he wants to score 6 every time. But when you look and think about it from the big picture, he's keeping his defense on the sideline, and it was a successful drive if they can convert the 3 right here.
He wants to score 10 every time.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Lanning is hit from 21, 39, and now 22 yards. 6 straight games, neither team had scored more than 20 points. Tonight they both have, and we still have 2:29 to go in the second quarter. Not a good night for defensive coordinators. Here is our Aflac trivia question again, which 2 Heisman Trophy winners met in the 1980 matchup between these schools. Come on, folks, you should have gotten this one. Herschel Walker and George Rogers. Number 4 Georgia, number 14 South Carolina met. Bulldog freshman Herschel Walker had a huge night, 43 for 219, including that 76-yard run. But George Rogers rushed for 168. But he also fumbled with 5:22 left on Georgia's 17-yard line, and the Bulldogs won it 13-10. How can you have that much rushing yardage and have only a 13-10 score?
And knowing George, I've got to defend him here. He's wondering now, why in the world would ESPN show me fumbling the football and letting Herschel go the distance?
We've seen him virtually every South Carolina game we've ever had. He's been around the stadium. Boy, was Herschel any good?
Oh man. I thought he was far better in college than the pro.
Me too.
Didn't you?
Brandon Smith is deep. Still plenty of time for fireworks, folks. This time they will not pooch it. Smith from the 12. Got a seam. Couldn't keep his balance. Got to the 40, and the kicker saved it. Adam Yates, the backup place kicker, just got enough.
When you don't kick the ball down the field with some hang time on it, you're in trouble. You just don't have time to get your guys back and the coverage down there to defend against speed. And you can't defend speed when it gets out on the corner.
Kickers don't make a lot of tackles, but boy, that was a big one. Did some huge kick returns in this game. Now Cox will go back to work. The toss to Thomas reverses his field. Sometimes when you run the wrong way, it works out. Well, this is a surprise just by its nature. Samuel back in. breaks a tackle just like he did early. And boy, this kid has, this is night and day from a week ago. I mean, he is just drilling people when he runs.
You know, a nice gain, but from up top, boy, I tell you, he missed an opportunity. Stay left, stay left, stay left. When you get through there, stay left. And maybe I'm being a little hard on the guy. He was getting hit and spinning, but man, that was, there was some opening to the outside.
You're applying Craig James standards.
No, George Rogers and Herschel Walker standards.
Flag is down. Would have been a first down inside the 10, but we checked the marker. And it's going to come back.
Holding, number 61 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. See first down.
That's the 294-pound center, Ben Jones. Mark Richt never seems to lose his cool. He's got the same temperament whether things are going well or going poorly.
Well, his motor's running on the inside pretty good. You know, yesterday in the meetings, we asked, we said, hey, we hear the fans around here are calling for an end zone celebration again. And he kind of smiled, you know, referring back to the Florida game.
Yeah.
You know, a couple of years ago when they all went out there and got the penalty. He said, well, we first need to get in the end zone.
First and 20, clock running, approaching the 1 minute mark. Cox with plenty of time. South Carolina had the shot at the interception. Darian Stewart had it go right through his hands to Michael Moore. What a break for Georgia. And now they're going to run the hurry up as the clock will restart.
Official timeout to measure the game.
And now they'll measure as they have reached just outside the 15-yard line.
You know what? A nice job. Ellis Johnson dialing up a different number here, getting to the quarterback, but just a little late. Joe Cox gets very lucky down the middle. This ball's not picked off, and the deflection to Michael Moore. And good for Michael Moore. Last week did not have a good game. Wasn't going to start because of the lack of performance and comes up with a big play here.
It's one of the few times with the pass rush from Cliff Matthews that South Carolina has applied any pressure at all. And they were so good against North Carolina State a week ago, particularly Devin Taylor, the left end, who just had a brilliant game. What is going on with some of these scores? Jacksonville State over Florida State.
That's late in the fourth quarter.
Jacksonville State. Yeah. And Florida International close to Alabama. Stops the clock with 42 seconds left.
A couple of times we've seen now screens and short passing attempts by Georgia. South Carolina's defense faster than what they're seeing in practice, and so it's off timing. And the receiver's not there. Quarterback's having to rush it. Just hands, too many hands in his face.
So it's just they try to convert the first down and do. Cox looked to the bench to see what they want.
Down the ball. Plays mean nothing here. I down it. Save your timeout.
Georgia has one left. Cox for the end zone. Jump ball incomplete. Intended for A.J. Green. That's a good place to throw it. Like C.C. Whitlock was the closest defender for South Carolina.
And you know what? An outstanding job of playing defense, getting back there. 5'10", you got to be right with your body, see the ball in the air, make the adjustment.
Recruited as a wide receiver. Only a freshman, again, part of that huge, tremendous recruiting class.
You know what? That play right there, by being incomplete, it allowed Georgia to huddle up, gather their thoughts for two plays, and then come out and ready to go.
Four wide receivers, A.J. Green to the top of your screen. They look the other way, go to Samuels on the little check down, and Samuels inside the 10. Clock is running. And now they will use the timeout. 16 seconds left in the half. Well, you like to see a kid like Cox with a smile on his face on the sideline. I mean, he was able to start one game a couple of years ago, came in relief a couple of years ago and did well. But to sit behind Matthew Stafford, and you know why people are going to sit behind Matthew Stafford, and now have a chance to play, it's got to be the greatest feeling in the world.
His offensive line showed up today, and they're doing well. The running game showed up today. They're doing well. So this has been a game that wasn't about Joe Cox. Joe Cox has gone out and done exactly what we thought he would do.
Right.
Execute the game plan. Get the ball in your playmakers' hands. Don't make mistakes. 9 of 15, but there are no interceptions there. He's not made the mistake.
Third and five. Samuel will be the tailback. Let's see where A.J. Green goes. It'll be to the left. Chappas is in the slot. To the end zone, A.J. Green, touchdown! Perfect throw from Cox. See if he got the foot down. It was right at the back of the end line. But A.J. Green, who had 56 catches for 963 yards a year ago.
Watch the drive, Mike. Watch how hard he drives to the back. Green works hard to get back to a point on the field. That left foot is down. He has absolute control of that football. But the fact that Green drove extremely hard while South Carolina's defenders were looking in the backfield, he got behind him. Green got behind the secondary, foot down on the left side, touchdown.
Augusti had man-to-man coverage, but was a step short. Nice catch by Green. And a beautiful throw by Joe Cox.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown.
This is why I love the NCAA review process. They don't fool around. And yet they check every play, and it doesn't make the game longer. It only makes sense to do it this way. And if you're Joe Cox and A.J. Green right now, you're on top of the world. You have put up 30 points on a defense that only gave up 3 a week ago, and you've done it in the first half.
9 seconds and a half.
Joe Cox, we just spoke about his ability to manage the game, knowing where his receiver was going to be. Before the snap, Mike, you said look for A.J. Green. You have to assume South Carolina's thinking look for A.J. Green. You know, Cox and his family were looking for A.J. Green. Sometimes the offense just does a better job than you do defending.
That's true.
What a game. What a half.
Unbelievable. And you're right. Sometimes, even if you know it's coming, I mean, when Herschel was here, you knew Herschel was going to get the ball 30 times a game, and 30 times a game you couldn't stop him. Sometimes the obvious play is the best play.
And go back and reflect to the beginning of this football game. South Carolina had 23-4 snaps to 2 or 3, 23 snaps to 3 snaps for Georgia.
Remarkable.
And you flip that around and score 31 points.
Yep. 9 seconds to go. Look at the kick returns. Georgia with a 100-yard return for a touchdown. And the 204 is a school record. So was the 100. And I'm sure the average is too. 51-3 for a game.
And I'm sure they're not finished.
No. Pooch punt with only 9 seconds to go, and it's fumble. and no time ran off the clock. You have to have possession.
South Carolina recovers.
South Carolina fortunate to get it back.
That'll make Spurrier right in front of himself pull out the indigestion tablets.
Justice Cunningham, a freshman tight end on special teams, bobbled it. And DJ Swearinger, another freshman, made the recovery. And now they are going to take 2 seconds off the clock.
A lot of young players on the field for both teams. Georgia last week, they played 7 true freshmen against Oklahoma State in some key positions. So these young guys starting to get a feel for the speed of college football.
Draw play. And then a run out the hand. What a half it was. Georgia, with the early turnovers, found itself in a hole, and they come back to take the lead. 31-23. Steve Spurrier contending there should be a second left. And they are still talking about this. Rick trying to make his case, and it looks like he's losing. Well, there's either a second left or there's none.
Under further review.
Now, I think the right foot went out at the 41.
Much ado about nothing, apparently. Let's check in with Heather.
Coach, you told us defensively your goal was to eliminate the run, really force Joe Cox to win the game. How much do you stick with that philosophy in the second half?
We just haven't played very well. They haven't had a lot of snaps, but obviously we hadn't stopped them much. But kickoff return, reverse, they've had a bunch of big plays that we've not given up in a long time. So if we can tighten up a bit, we're still in the ball game, obviously.
Coach, after scoring 7 points last week, you vowed to be more aggressive offensively. What specifically have you done to ignite it?
We should have scored some touchdowns. It's hard to get in a scoring game and have to kick field goals. So.
Coach, thanks for your time. Mike?
Thank you, Heather. Our score at halftime, Georgia 31, South Carolina 23. SEC on ESPN. We're at the half in Athens, Georgia, where South Carolina comes calling and trails 31-23 at the half. Now, we've been doing this a long time, and we promised you a defensive struggle. And there have only been, what, 54 points in the first half? Are we good or what?
I'm telling you, we know exactly what we're talking about up here. You know, this is really one of those games where I think now Georgia comes out of the locker room and they say, we're going to pound the football and take away the heart of South Carolina's football team. If Georgia can get the ground game going to take away that defense over there, the spirit will leave the sidelines of South Carolina.
Well, it's already been a shocking outcome as these two teams who thought they would have tremendous defensive performances and maybe squeak out a few points. Whoever got a big play would be lucky and come out as the winner, but it hasn't worked out that way. Boykin, who had the 100-yard kickoff return, swallowed up this time as he got back to the 20-yard line. And now for tonight's game track, brought to you by John Hancock. First half stats, Georgia with 270, or South Carolina, 275 total yards. And Georgia with 204 kick return yards. That sets a school record. They also had the 100-yard kickoff return for a touchdown that set a school record. This time, however, they start from their own 20-yard line. Samuel on the toss. He's had a good ball game. He has run very, very hard, and we check in with Heather.
Guys, I was able to talk to Mark Rick, specifically asked him about the controversy at the end of the first half. He said his frustration with the fact that the clock should have started once the returner touched the ball, that he bobbled it, so clearly 2 seconds should have passed off the clock. Other than that, Mark Rick told me, CJ, to look for a few minor offensive tweaks. He also said after the defense was on the field for nearly the entire first quarter, they need to do a better job keeping them off the field in the second half. And guys, Brandon Boykin, who has been treated for cramps, back on the field on that kick return.
All right, Heather, we'll see how long he can last, because usually when you get them, no matter what the treatment is, they're going to come back. Cox. Got a tremendous ball game. Goes to Green. He's forced out of bounds by Stewart.
Man, that's a great ball. Wow, what a throw over a linebacker dropping into the passing zone. Patience in the pocket. A senior guy, been there, done this before. Not a lot, but look at the patience and the ball right over Norwood's hands. Excellent job.
Now, Heather told you at the beginning of the ball game about the atrophy in one of the muscles in his shoulder. But it doesn't affect his velocity. It doesn't affect his throwing motion. Just the durability and how many times he can throw. That's why they give him one day off during the week where he doesn't throw, so he doesn't get that tired arm syndrome. During a game, it should have no effect because he's not going to throw it 65 times.
And this all dates back to the spring when it really started going. So it's not like a brand new occurrence that they're having to deal with. He's had treatment. He's had specialty work on it. He's prepared mentally for it. He understands that by taking those reps and practice on Tuesday and then taking off some Wednesday, he's okay with that. The team's okay with that.
And he's also been a baseball player throughout his career. So that's, you know, that's just more wear and tear on that rotator cuff. Samuel again pounds his way across the 40. And most orthopedics will tell you that the human body, the shoulder, is not designed to do this kind of thing, to throw a baseball or throw a football.
And I had a nerve issue one time on the back of my shoulder, very similar to what Joe's talking about. I had to have a cyst drained to get the pressure off the nerve. I had the atrophy in the back of my shoulder, and it took me several years of working, and I wasn't even an athlete then, so it took a while for me to get it back. So something that happened in the spring, it's going to take some months of rehab.
Third down, about three. Samuel offset this time as the running back. Cox pump fake. Goes deep. A.J. Green is open. That should be interference, and it will be. Akeem Augusti got turned around and did the only thing he could. And that was just grab A.J. Green and make sure he wasn't going to make the catch. It'd be a 15-yard penalty. It's different from the NFL. It is not a spot foul.
Pass interference. Number three on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Georgia will take this all night long. You give A.J. Green a chance with his 6'4 body, the leading returning receiver from the SEC last year, against a 5'10 defensive back. You're either going to catch the football or you're going to get the pass interference.
South Carolina with those two really good corners, Gilmore and Augusti, was man to man, and they beat him that time. Smith, the speedster. Couldn't get by Norwood, had enough of them to hang on and wait for help, and it was came in the person of Darian Stewart.
That's part of that package that we were told they would have for him. He was late getting the handoff. The timing was off. His relationship to his lead blocker was off. And when you're behind him, I don't care how fast you are, had he been one or 1.5 yards closer, That ball is around the corner.
And isn't that the effect? He practices as a defensive back. He's on all the special teams, and they put in a package for him on offense. Mm-hmm. You can't do everything. Although he comes pretty close. Cox, nice throw to Green. Got away from McDusty. Stiff arm. Wrapped around the neck, taken out of bounds at the 5. Saving tackle by Cliff Matthews, the defensive end chasing the play. But it's a gain of 34 yards. This guy's the real deal.
And so is his quarterback, Joe Cox, weak shoulder and all, with a firm pass to Green so that he can turn and defend himself against the tackler. Great job, quarterback, and an outstanding job by Green. Green's a strong player, putting the foot in the ground, moving down the field. Strong 6'4" frame.
Boy, Gusty's got to make that tackle. First and goal. Samuel. Did a nice job of stringing that one out. And a nice play by Alonzo Winfield, the strong side linebacker. He just would not let Samuel go anywhere. And there's a marker down as well. Crowd's already booing as the Georgia team is marching backward. South Carolina says that's the direction we want them to go.
East and west against South Carolina net speeds, mighty hard to accomplish.
Illegal block in the back. Number 82 on the offense. 10-yard penalty for the previous spot. Deep first down.
Michael Moore, wide receiver.
You know, he's got to know that's just not thinking. You know, that's not being a smart football player. And does it matter? Well, maybe they score 3, maybe they score 7, but what happens if they don't? You know, plays like that, what's the penalty? It could be the game.
That's right. Georgia's been hit for 10 flags for 90 yards. So Cox and his offense pushed back to the 15-yard line. Samuel bursts across the 10, pinned at the 7. Ben Jones, the center, led him right up the middle.
I know the package I would have for Samuel as a runner, and it's between the tackles. It's not outside the tackles. Boy, he brings it downhill when he's in between those tackles. He's coming.
Averaging almost 5.5 yards a shot. Second and goal. Samuel again, same play to the 4. And Darian Stewart, the strong side safety, had to make the tackle. You know, Samuel now over 50 yards, Craig.
And you see the call at the line of scrimmage. Cox is up there reading, looking at angles. He sees his men up front, knowing that he's got a power back behind him. And having a senior, though, with the intelligence of a coach, he wants to coach, hopes to get a GA job at Georgia.
I like smart quarterbacks. Especially smart quarterbacks that have some athletic skills to go with them. He's got both. Cox underneath, touchdown. Well, that was just too easy. Wide open was Michael Moore. He's got lost. There went the Saul within 5 yards. This is a South Carolina defense that gave up 3 points last week and 133 total yards. 133. That is staggeringly good. Right now they're getting shredded. Moore. Nobody near him. Cox hit his last 5 for 62 yards and 2 touchdowns. This team now up by 15. Six minutes, 59 seconds to go in the third quarter from Athens, Georgia. Beautiful college town.
Great. You know, last night, Really good dinner at the Porterhouse. Outstanding meal. Loved it.
I can hear your check being torn up now.
Thank you, darling.
Garcia on third and long, four-man rush. Trying to get it himself. Hurdles taken down to 22. They need to get to the 20. Now it might be decision time as Rennie Curran stopped it.
Oh, I said if they got close, they might go for it. Oh, okay.
They're close.
I think they got to go for it.
They mark it at the 21, so it's fourth and a yard. Well, a field goal here would only cut it to 12. I think Steve Spurrier has the feeling these are not the only points that Georgia's going to get.
Absolutely, and you heard him tell Heather going in at halftime, we got to stop getting three, we need six.
Maddox, the deep man in the eye. Maddox will get the first down and a yard to spare. Well, regardless of what happens in this ball game, you get the feeling Steve Spurrier has found himself a quarterback that can run his system.
And I think because he's got an offensive line doing a pretty good job up front, it's allowed Garcia to make some plays down the field. Great development.
Garcia floats one for the end zone. Jump ball incomplete. The fans wanted offensive interference on Gurley. He was beautifully covered by Prince Miller. But it's tough to get offensive interference calls.
And, you know, it looked like it was just they got their feet tangled together. Incidental contact. But Gurley's got to come down, focus on this ball. Incidental, yep.
Boy, and that just rattled off his face mask, didn't it?
Sure did.
That's not good.
Gurley's only a freshman. He's got a lot of upside. He shows you flashes of brilliance at times, and then he also shows you at times that he's a freshman.
Second and 10. Garcia right down the middle, intended for Saunders. Too strong. And Garcia upset with himself, thought he had him open.
Absolutely. Now, this is a hard throw for a quarterback because you've got to get it just over that linebacker level. But from the left side of your screen here, you're going to see the big tight end. Saunders has it. Gets right behind the linebacker level, gets to the middle of the field. Tough throw to get it in there, but, boy, you got to get that over there. And Garcia would love to have the throw again.
Third down. Garcia throws as he's hit, incomplete. Now fourth and 10. I don't know that you can go for it.
No, you got to kick it now. You have to kick it now. But I would have had the mindset, you know, in the huddle that we're in four down territory again and managed it accordingly. Miscommunication between the tight end and the quarterback. He thought his tight end was going to go to the flat, and he hooked up.
Geno Atkins was putting the pressure on. So Lanning, who has already made three, is on for a 35-yarder. They still need two touchdowns. But they cut the lead to 12. Lanning has had a big night. At least for South Carolina, the drive pays off. We have 5:30 to go in the quarter in Athens. Welcome back to Athens. A field goal has cut the lead to 12, 38-26. Georgia over South Carolina. And Joe Cox will have another shot on offense. Let's take a look back at our Sears drive recap.
Well, we're going to show you three passes in this drive, but it was the six runs that set up the three successful passes. A.J. Green with the broken tackles, the ball down the left sideline, and then the touchdown pass later after that going to Michael Moore. So the run, six of them, strong, effective, and that really opened up the passing game.
Boykin, the deep man, he of the 100-yard return earlier. And another big one. And another
shot for Boykin from the four. Runs into his own man, taken down at the 23-yard line. Wendy, thanks very much. This one's still hanging in the balance with 5:24 to go in the third quarter. It's 38-26. Samuel, the tailback, Cox fakes it to him. Pressure, and Cox gets away and gains maybe a yard. One of the few times that South Carolina has had pressure. Clifton Gathers, number 96, described by one of the Georgia coaches as the biggest human being they had ever seen at 6'8", 281. And Cox comes out. Zach Mettenberger, a freshman, checks in. No, check it. It's Logan Gray, the sophomore. There's a package in for him. He gives it to Samuel. Samuel swallowed up in the backfield. He's hit immediately by Melvin Ingram, who has the oddest number for a defensive lineman. He's number six. At one point, he was a kick returner and has sort of grown out of that job. And now Cox will come back in. Gray, they had a red zone package in for him last week. He's a kid that can run the entire offense, but he has no game experience. Joe Cox, the only quarterback on the roster with that. So now third and long for Cox, and he goes to the shotgun. Four-man rush. I don't think I've ever seen so many plays whistled dead 4 or 5 seconds in.
Before the snap, false start, number 72 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
That's Vincent Vance again.
Now, Mark Richt put Logan Gray in for a purpose. It wasn't to hand the ball off. He really wanted that quarterback zone read that he did there. He gave the football to the back. When they watch film study, Gray's going to say, man, why didn't I keep that football? Because there's no way that defensive end could have hung with me around the corner. It would have been a nice game.
Third and 16 now after the penalty. They'll be coming after Cox this time. And they worked the screen. Well, it was nicely defensed by South Carolina. Chris Culliver cut him down. So they got pressure on Cox. It was the right call. They set up the screen. The South Carolina was ready for that too.
Absolutely, they were ready for it. Defensive coordinator Ellis Johnson, been around the SEC a long time, did a nice job of getting his guys ready to go, put them in the right position to stop Georgia.
Thought that was very important for the South Carolina defense after the field goal to come out and be able to stop Georgia. Augusti is deep for Drew Butler's punt. Big snap over his head. That's going to be a safety. Holy cow. The snapper, Ty Fricks. Or was it Fricks? Yes, Ty Fricks.
It doesn't take much for momentum to change significantly. Three plays, your offense out of sync, and it all started on an incompletion on first down. Things turn around quickly, and when they do, the defense is usually the reason for it. South Carolina's defense stepped up. Three plays, forced the punt, attempt, and then the bad snap.
Butler had no chance. Ty's dad was also a long snapper back in 81 and 82. He is now an orthopedic surgeon. And that was not a surgical snap from Fritz. Airmailed to the end zone. So it's 38-28. That takes it back to a touchdown and a field goal instead of two touchdowns. So that's a huge play. And Georgia will have to kick to South Carolina. Nobody ever pays attention to the deep snapper until he whiffs one.
No, no, there's no question about that. And then to further support what Georgia's offense has been doing in the previous six possessions, four touchdowns, a field goal, and one punt. So for them to, South Carolina to come out three and out, humongous.
Walsh to kick to Augusti. Near the sideline from the 22. Cut it back up the middle, takes it to the 37-yard line. They will start from there.
Watch it on little old black and white TV with rabbit ears. Listen to Howard Cosell call Monday Night Football.
You still do the canned peaches on Monday night?
Absolutely. Sometimes it's the only thing in my house. Maryland's quit cooking on me. But I'm serious. I was in college. I get in an elevator. We're playing in the Holiday Bowl. And Howard Cosell walks in the elevator with us. And I'm telling you, I was like, holy mackerel, that's Howard Cosell.
Bigger than life, wasn't he?
And he acted it, too.
Yes, he did. Howard knew how to hold court. From the 45-yard line, Garcia draw Giles. He had great quickness pulled down this time, though. Rennie Kern was right there. He wasn't going to let him go.
Giles draw carry.
One of the most entertaining times I ever spent was sitting at a table in a restaurant in D.C. a couple of seats away from Howard Cosell, just being entertained and put down and everything else. But he was something.
So you had to be thick-skinned to hang around Cosell?
Oh, my Lord. He was a piece of work. Just short. Let's check in with Heather.
Well, guys, everyone in this South Carolina program is talking about the huge difference they see in quarterback Stephen Garcia between last year and this year. A lot of the credit goes to first-year quarterback coach G.A. Mangus, who played for and coached for Spurrier at Florida. So he knows Spurrier's offense and, maybe more importantly, understands Spurrier.
Good point, Heather.
Heather, I think that is the point. I think that is the most important thing. If he played for Steve Spurrier, he understands the psychological ups and downs of playing for him. Giles dives for the first down. This is going to be close. Heather?
Well, really what Mangus does is acts as a liaison between coach and quarterback. And interestingly, Mangus is on headset on the field. Most are usually up in the coach's box. But Mangus really taking advantage of the location. I've watched after every series. There's tons of communication with Garcia, breaking down offensive efficiency, and truly a test right here for Stephen Garcia, guys.
And having a younger coach able to communicate with a younger athlete, and it's a cultural difference. You know, I remember Coach Krzyzewski, Coach K said at Duke one time, I was at a basketball tournament watching, and he starts talking about he had his younger coaches to deal and to convey his thoughts, to break them down.
Sure.
Here's what I mean by that. Here's what coach is meaning by this.
Inches shy. It's be the play of the game right here. I mean, if you don't make it on your side of the 50, you're really handing the opposition a huge advantage in field position. What do you call on fourth and an inch? Quarterback keeper?
I put it behind my strong left side there. I formation, lead in there with a fullback and go.
Giles, the scat back, and he's got it. A little unconventional. You go with your little guy on the outside, but he had the speed and it worked.
Willie Martinez, the defensive coordinator at Georgia, was thinking, like me, inside, they go outside. Very nice call, but you've got the numbers. You've got the leverage to the outside. You see the blocking down. Everybody was on Georgia's defense, gunning and pinning and slanting to the inside of the ball.
Nice block by DeMarco, too, on the outside. Got two guys with a little chip and just threw off their stride. Garcia with time. Now he scrambles. Giles. Oh, this guy's got a future. This kid has some quick moves.
And so does his teammate Garcia.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that just watching the development, like Heather was talking about, not only from last year, from last week. Last week, Garcia would have tucked that ball and been gone running. He's just seeing the field a lot better today. We saw it take force. He had the quarterback of Michigan last
Absolutely.
Week, the freshman.
Absolutely.
How composed he was.
Clock winding down here in the third quarter. Garcia was second and about three at the Georgia 43. Blitz coming. They pick it up well, and he completes the pass for a first down and more. And that's Kenny Miles making his first catch of the ball game.
Amazing.
Deion LaCorn, not Kenny Miles, 18 instead of 19.
What a bad snap will do. A three and out for your offense. All of a sudden, your defense is back on the field, and there's a lot of pressure on them now. What's delicate here is Willie Martinez not dialing up something that allows a big play. Make them be the methodical.
Kern showing blitz, and he comes. They pick it up. Garcia rifles it down the middle to the 16-yard line. Another first down. Jason Barnes. Boy, and Fricks is the guy on the sideline who was just hoping that the defense holds right here. He doesn't want that bad snap to cost him any more than it already has. Welcome back to the SEC on ESPN as we enter the fourth quarter in Athens, Georgia. It's a 38-28 game, but South Carolina is driving to cut into that lead. What a good ball game this has been. And a very unanticipated offensive shot. Garcia with the first and 10 at the Georgia 15-yard line. His running back is Giles. Looks Giles' way, then has to scramble, and they got it. Giles was not looking back. And when Garcia looked his way, Giles still had his head turned downfield, and he had to take off and couldn't get away from Gamble.
Willie Martinez and Georgia's defense, they gamble, and they got lucky. The wheel route was wide open. Watch it. Beat, burn, let the ball go to the back of the end zone, but the pressure in Garcia's face took his eyes off the secondary and on the defenders.
Now they have to be careful they don't run themselves out of field goal range.
That's their first time out of the second.
And Georgia will take a timeout on defense. So each team has two left. Seen a couple of defensive timeouts tonight.
Well, and it's usually that one's surprising, coming right after a big play by your defense, yeah. You know, and it looked like maybe somebody was nicked up a little bit over there, but Georgia's defense is tired. There's no question about that. They've got their hands on their hips, and they're being challenged right now.
Hey, we started this game at 7 o'clock. I'm tired.
Well, special teams is the reason we've been here a long time, because we've been watching a lot of highlights. 100-yard return early in the game set the pace and the tempo for the expectations.
Then the fumble. Fumbled.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we were all over the board. The fake punt. South Carolina needed that. Over the head.
Well, we've had just about everything, haven't we? Touchdowns, turnovers, huge plays. Pressure coming. Garcia floats it for the end zone. Out of bounds. Caught by Gurley. But he was out of bounds, and Brandon Smith was right in front of him with his back turned and his hands up and his fingers crossed.
Well, how smart was that true freshman not to make contact, though, right? Here you go with a big man. Gurley down the left side. Let the ball go sooner, though, Garcia. See it and feel it. He's just out of bounds. Right foot just lands out.
And Gurley, even though the pass was out of bounds, he has to be a little more aware of where he is. Now they're going to go on 3rd and 21. Do you try to get some of it to get better field goal position, or do you try to go all? Garcia's got room in front of him. Now he throws. Gurley. And Gurley near the original line of scrimmage at about to 17. This will give him a much better shot at a field goal.
Yeah, absolutely. Take the three for sure here. Back to the middle of the field. An outstanding play again by Steven Garcia. You know what? Knowing that his feet would not have gotten him that far down the field, it would have been a waste for him to run the ball.
He's made really good decisions. And the one turnover, the interception that he threw, took a tremendous play by Boykin to pick it off. So now you've got Lanning, who's had a big night with four field goals. And he cuts the lead to seven. Lanning has been perfect. That's 5-4-5 for the junior place kicker. And it's 38-31, Georgia. Well, we're back to a touchdown difference at 38-31. Going to go to one of the upmen taken out to the 33-yard line by Munzenmeyer. Well, two-pointers have played a big part tonight, haven't they?
Wait a minute. Wasn't that supposed to be the score here?
Yes, it
and
was.
In Columbus, something different?
Yes.
We were supposed to have 12-10. 4-3, 3-2.
We got to 12-10 in a heartbeat.
That was a wise kickoff decision there. Shane Beamer and his boys looking at it saying, look, if we kick it deep, there's a chance it's going 100 against
us. Please reset the clock to 13:05.
Well, you certainly know it's going to go around 45, because that's what they've averaged. So pretty good field position anyway. They'll start from the 33-yard line. Cotts has had a big night at quarterback for Georgia. Tailback on this series will be Thomas. Cox intercepted. Picked off by Norwood. The All-SEC linebacker touchdown. He saw that one coming, stepped in front like it was intended for.
I've watched this young man play in three or four football games. Every game I call of his, he blocks kicks, returns fumbles, has touchdowns.
He's special.
Mike, there's just something about the young man. Now, as for Georgia, the last two series, they've opened up with a pass on first down, and neither have worked.
You just know Norwood recognized the play, knew where it was going, got, and that one's blocked. So Georgia will keep the lead because they blocked the extra point. Holy cow. Kenny Davis celebrating. And on the most routine of plays, Georgia comes through and Norwood just grabbed that out of nowhere and takes off for Pater.
You think special teams are important tonight?
Oh. This is already the second highest scoring game between South Carolina and Georgia ever. The highest scoring is back in 1970 when they racked up a combined 86 points. Who knows? Might get there after all. There is Tyson, who blocked the extra point. D'Angelo, a sophomore defensive tackle, got a hand up and at least temporarily saved the game. Here's another pooch punt. And the fair catch made by Munzenmeyer.
Let's go back and look then at the interception for the touchdown. Eric Norwood, you'll see, is right here in the linebacker, right? Watch the footwork of Joe Cox. He looks at the middle of the field. As soon as he turns, I'm not sure why he can't see Norwood. He's right there in his vision. It's almost like he turned just ready to throw it regardless. Didn't look, didn't read, nothing. Not a senior move.
Norwood had seen that play before, recognized it this time.
D'Angelo Tyson's only 6'2", but he timed it just right. He had great push and penetration to get up and make the play. And special teams just like this kickoff right here, limiting the Georgia return that's been averaging the 45 you're talking about.
Yeah.
Just smart moves. The special teams so important in this game.
So Lanning is 5 for 5 on field goals, but has an extra point block. And Georgia continues to lead, albeit by only 1 point this time. Now they'll go with a run playing Carlton Thomas. And a good game for almost 9 following Ben Jones. And let's check in with Heather.
Even after the pick six, guys, you get the sense down here on the sideline that this Georgia team still has the utmost confidence in their quarterback. And they have for a while. At the end of spring practice, Mark Richter met with each player and, among things, asked them who the leader of this team was. 106 players answered Joe Cox, even though he entered 2009 unproven, which is one career start. Coach Rick said there's not a player or a coach on this team who doesn't have confidence in him. And Mark, before the game, guys, said he can't worry about mistakes. He's got to play with passion. That's loud and clear right now, guys.
Well, certainly he has done that. And outside the one mistake, Heather, he has played very, very good football.
And you know what? And to Eric Norwood's credit now, here's a guy not many can do what he just did.
That's,
you know,
for sure.
Know the passing lane, make the pick, take it to the house. So he was better player,
and that thing was a bullet, and he was only about 3 yards behind the line of scrimmage. Third and a yard, huge play here. Munzenmeyer is into the ball game as an extra blocker. Another tight end is in there. Samuel is the tailback. He'll get the carry, and he's got the first down. Well, you just know he's going to get it as hard as he has run tonight.
You know, you think about this offensive line at Georgia last week. Trenton Sturdivant, a returning player who was a great player at left tackle, re-injured his knee. I mean, just an absolutely a terrible situation. But you've got a replacement, Vincent Vance, there, 72, doing his job. You know, knowing the down and distance, finding your man, matching up, driving him out of there.
A terrible break for Sturdivant. Hurt in the opening game 2 years in a row. Samuel, nice hole straight up the middle. Pounds for him to the 47, maybe the 48-yard line. And they're getting a little chippy out there on both sides.
When Georgia came out of the locker room, they had a touchdown drive, 6 runs, 3 passes. You know, they're getting back now to where it's up front. The offensive line having to take control of this game, get it back on their side.
Well, if you can dominate up front, this is the time you want to do it in the fourth quarter. And now Cox says, I need a timeout. That'll be number 2 for Georgia. And these things could be very precious in about 45 minutes from now. Got a timeout. 38-37, Georgia over South Carolina. What a ball game. Welcome back to Athens, Georgia. Still 10 minutes and 16 seconds to go in this ball game, and it is 38-37, Georgia over South Carolina.
You know, Mike, that's a good point you make. This is a long football game that's early in the season, and your ability to stay focused and on track as a player is challenged. It's challenging. You know, Joe Cox looks over and automatically throws the out, makes a mistake. You know, coaches need to remind their players, guys, stay in the game.
Second and 3 for Georgia. Up by 1, trying to pad their lead on this drive. Samuel turns the corner, knocked out of bounds close to the sticks.
That's about as good as I've seen him turn the corner, running the corner. You know, if he does it like that around the corner every time, then I'd take him from tackle to tackle, not push him out there some. Joe Cox is counting numbers. He's looking. He gets the line of the scrimmage. He's trying to find his options right side. Now we're going to go unbiased over on the right. Left. Coming left.
Samuel. His feet taken out from under him by Augusti. But that should be enough for a first down.
You know, here's what I'm talking about. When you see the numbers out there, you're trying to give your offensive line and your fullback a chance. Left guard, left tackle. You're going to see left guard, left tackle. They're going to block. They've got their man. The fullback has the linebacker that's there. It's a fullback's guy. One-on-one, boom, there you go.
Boy, and he buried the linebacker, too. Charles. Boy, they say Charles for those big games over the middle. He's averaging better than 20 yards a catch in two ball games.
And you know what? The coaching staff, Mike Bobo, said we want to find our tight ends more. Orson Charles, an outstanding job of making sure he catches the ball. He's a true freshman. As he gets older, he'll have more confidence to continue to keep his feet with him, catch that ball running, more yards after catch.
He's 6'3", 230 out of Tampa. And it's a first down at the 29-yard line. Clock continues to run. We're now inside 9 minutes. Blitz. Down to the 14, another first down. King makes the catch. Stephon Gilmore, who has not been in on any big plays so far tonight, makes the tackle there.
I'll give you another name you have not called, or I have tonight, Devin Taylor, who last week wreaked havoc on NC State. He's done nothing tonight. There he is on the sideline. Taylor last week blocked kicks, returned fumbles, did everything else. Nothing much tonight.
Carlton Thomas, the tailback, cock fakes it. Look out for behind, loose ball. Georgia got it back out at the 30, but Cox, Stephon Gilmore got a free run and just creamed him.
It'll be off the edge, off the left side of your screen here. You won't see him. He's so far out there, unblocked, unaccounted for on the left side, comes flying in. Blind side of Cox.
Oh.
Just like that.
Awesome. He's almost lucky he's going to get up from that one.
Absolutely.
Oh. The impact of that is enormous. Mm. And Georgia very fortunate to get the ball back. And a 5-yard penalty on top of it.
And obviously here in this football game at 38-37, 41-37, a field goal really makes a big difference in it at the end of this ball game.
Carlton Thomas made the recovery. The ball's all the way back to the 34. They have to go inside the 5 to get a first down. And from here, we're talking a 52-yard field goal try. Game 6 or 7 as Carlton Thomas takes it around right in. Of course, we have already seen Blair Walsh doesn't have much of a limit on his leg for field goal distance.
That focus that I was talking about just a moment ago, where your player tends to take a play off, it only takes one play, a hit from behind, the ball bounces right, it's picked up by somebody and it's going the other direction. And just like that, you've got a different score.
Third and a mile. The one thing Cox can't do here is take a sack. Pressure coming. Green on the flanker screen. Had his legs cut out from under him at the 24. This will set up a makeable field goal try for landing about 41 yards.
It's a good point to make about not taking a sack there, and a great call by Mike Bobo, the coordinator, knowing that he's got a screen. He's going to get rid of it. It might not be complete, but he's going to quickly get rid of the football.
Blair Walsh, the only two he's had a shot at this year, 53 and 50. Boy, he's perfect again. This guy's money. $41.37. the field goal by Blair Walsh, and Georgia can breathe slightly easier. South Carolina will get the ball back. Plenty of time on the clock. 6:20 to go. Culliver, who's had some good returns, is the deep man.
There's that quarterback coach Mangus that Heather was talking about in that relationship on the sidelines. Reminder, hey, here's what you're doing, trying to get it done.
Culliver waits at his 7. Are down, so is Culliver at the
30.
And it looks like what was decent field position is going to be
during the return,
back.
Holding number 31 on the receiving team, 10 yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first and 10.
Gerard Sinclair, a senior linebacker, called. So they'll start in a hole, first and 15. Garcia with good protection to Saunders, the tight end. Trying for extra yardage, gets it up to the 24. They need to reach the 29, and Saunders with 7 catches tonight and 11 in this short two-game season.
Now, what I liked about that, that's a formation change by South Carolina. They put Saunders on the outside, had him go up and delay and hook to the inside. He's been the inside, first inside receiver until that one there. A formation change, and it threw Georgia off.
I'm going to try to find that guy.
So is Georgia.
The tailback, Giles, Burrows up to the 27-yard line. They have to get to the 29, remember, for the first down. South Carolina with 2 timeouts left and 5:20 on a turning clock. This game has already lasted 3 hours and 43 minutes. Holy cow, 408 yards and kick return.
Well, Lee Corso said, in game day this morning, that this was going to be a boring football game. Had a lot of fans in the press box say, hey, you tell Corso he was wrong about that one.
I think Lee will admit he missed this one. Garcia, incomplete, but a late flag intended for Gurley. Vance Cuff was right with him. Is it interference? He was sure thrown in the area where they call that.
Pass interference, number 25 on the defense. That penalty will be enforced at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
What a huge first down.
Absolutely it was, and I think Cuff was on his back. Gurley was driving, trying to get up the field, bottom of your screen. He's holding, he's got his hands on both sides of him. That definitely is a penalty.
Boy, the linebacker on the short side knew it was going to be a slant, nearly blocked it. Garcia, draw play, no. Cade Weston made the tackle when Brian Evans, the safety, hustled up and made the ball carrier change his course. Good play by Evans.
This is such an important ball game for both teams. Really especially important for Georgia because this is a team that had expectations to do something this season. And what's something? 9-10 wins. South Carolina, important for them to get over the hump. They're still trying to get there. They're trying to get up where they can win and win consistently against the top teams in the SEC.
Blitz coming, pass in the flat. The fullback, DeMarco, taken out at the 40. You know, right now, partner, with 4:04 to go, it's looking more and more like this is going to be the last South Carolina drive. And I think they're trying to do everything in a measured way right now because they realize it, too. If they give up the ball now, they're probably not going to get it back. So get your best plays together because you're going to need them right now.
And how about that play there to the sideline so that the clock stops after the reception?
Another big third down. Garcia 27 of 45 tonight. 271 yards passing. And he still needs more. Blitz coming out in the flat. He's got his tailback. He's got another first down. Brian Maddox made the catch. Stayed in bounds, but it's a first down.
Okay, now you said you'd be finding Saunders, your tight end, right? Georgia this time, you see Saunders over on the left side of your screen. They cover up the tight end, who's been catching all these balls on the third and short. Now they got a different option to hit it with, and a nice job of the receiver, Maddox, getting out there catching it.
South Carolina needs a touchdown. A field goal won't help. Remember the blocked point after. That makes it a four-point game instead of a three-point game. They're burning an awful lot of time trying to pick up 5 yards of the shot. Now Garcia will go deep, intended for Gurley, and he dropped it. Boy, there have been a lot of shots that Gurley could have come up with. Cuff was with him, and Spurrier wanted an interference call.
You know, psychologically, that the defensive back knows the ball's coming. He's reading the eyes. And you've got Cuff covering, who just had a pass interference call against him. So he's double concerned about this, gets his hands up, and Gurley's just got to get better control of his body. As the ball arrives to him, he's got to get better control so he can make that catch.
Well, he turned around, and he's backpedaling, and that's not good body control. And Garcia didn't help him a lot. He needed to get that ball further out. Pressure coming again. Garcia on the run. He keeps it, cuts it back inside, dives to the 45-yard line, may have another first down. That was a heck of a run. Gamble had a shot at him and couldn't get him as he cut inside. Courageous run by Garcia.
Garcia hasn't run that often tonight, but when he has, he's been very effective with it. I think Gamble, number 50, the linebacker, was assuming Garcia was going down. The typical quarterback going to hit the dirt.
Third and inches, quarterback keeper, first down.
And a very nice job of Garcia getting to the line of scrimmage, going ahead, getting the first down so that the clock will stop.
Oh, what a ball game this has been. This has been sensational. And Saunders has got to be gassed. Everybody on that field's got to be gassed. They've been out there for a long, long time. Garcia attempts, completions, and yards, all career highs tonight. They have found a quarterback. Well, they found an offensive line, too. These guys have done a good job. Garcia, Gurley got that one at the 26 for a first down. A long, long crossing pattern. It's the best pattern in the world if you have time.
You know, we've talked about Troy Gurley as a freshman, that he shows you flashes of brilliance. The fact that he stayed hard driving across the field, that long route you're talking about, it gave an option to Steven Garcia.
If you have that much time to run across the field, you can run away from anybody. Under 2 minutes to go.
Georgia doesn't want to blitz that often because they now have confidence in Garcia's ability to beat them deep. So he's really playing a lot more vanilla on defense.
To the end zone, a bump and no flag. Good play by Evans. Was intended for more. He was covered very, very well. Stops the clock at the 136 mark.
Yeah, Brian Evans is known as a big hitter. And, you know, it was an outstanding job of seeing the ball, both receiver and defender, seeing the ball coming down, making the adjustments. Evans, a nice play.
This will be the 11th play of the drive. South Carolina still with two timeouts left. So they need not rush. Spun down at the 13-yard line. Vance Cuff makes another tackle. Holy cow.
The game of chess now. Willie Martinez, defensive coordinator, you see these guys here, when they come in, it's going to open up the field. Georgia's really been poor at identifying routes on the underneath patterns tonight, and the trend continues.
Okay, there's going to be some real tired chess players. Been a very physical game. Maddox draw. Well, I've been waiting for that call, and apparently so has the Georgia defense.
Boy, how important now, again, back to alluding to it, the blocked extra point after the Norwood touchdown, right? You know, this is the difference now. Just recently, not long ago, big interception return, touchdown. You're thinking automatic, no biggie, extra point blocked.
Otherwise, what you're looking at now is a chip shot field goal to tie it. And South Carolina looking at the end zone just for gravy. They get a touchdown, they win, but they've got a field goal in their back pocket. Well, they don't have that field goal in their back pocket anymore. They've got to have that touchdown. They just used their second timeout. They've got one left and 57 seconds left to go in the ball game.
But you know what? The one thing about this red zone down here tonight for Steven Garcia has been that he's had Gurley, a big receiver that he can throw to, and he's got the tight end that he can find as well. So I think right now I'd be talking to Georgia's defense, telling them to make sure you're reading the routes and see the game. I know you're tired. You got to see the game, feel the routes, particularly underneath.
Don't you like the tight end a little bit better, because they seem to have been able to cover Gurley? They haven't been able to stop Saunders.
No, they have not. But and again, it was a formation change. The last time that they were able to connect with him, put him on the outside, let him leap on the inside. So chess match taking place here. The number one thing I'd say is Georgia defense, you got to see the routes.
Second and 10 from the 13-yard line. Garcia underneath, Maddox makes the catch, gets to the 7. They need to reach the 3 for a first down. They gotta hurry.
Another underneath route there, get the ball in your playmaker's hands. Those Georgia linebackers now, as the field gets tighter, they'll be closer to the underneath route. It's easier to cover them up.
And now Georgia will use its second timeout. And if there's any question about what defense you're in, that's a smart call. You don't want any confusing and give up an easy, cheap one.
Absolutely. A great, great call there, especially on this drive when Steven Garcia, this freshman quarterback, on the road out here doing what he's doing. I mean, an outstanding job of the sophomore going down the field, seeing what's out there for him, putting the ball in the hands of the open receiver, not forcing things. And of course, I will say this, the receivers on this series working really hard for their quarterback. They're driving, trying to get to his vision so that he can make the play.
I think I'm right on this. I didn't see Saunders in on the last play.
He did not. He was not in.
Okay.
He was not. They had an I formation. They were the 3 receivers out there. They did not have him in.
I'd like to have him on the field if I'm South Carolina.
That's what I'm thinking.
I mean, don't you want a target who's 6'5", 280, who is bedeviled them all night long? South Carolina's run 82 offensive plays in this game to 52 for Georgia. Garcia, another good drive.
There's your big fella right there, isn't it?
Third down, he's tough to miss. And Garcia, maybe the first poor pass he's thrown in the second half. That was behind Gurley, who was running a slant, a quick post.
He's supposed to run to a spot. He's supposed to run to the corner to drive him off and get the first down. Curl at the first down. Gurley went more between the two defenders and the wrong path for what Garcia thought he was doing.
All right, this is it. They have to get the first down or the touchdown. Garcia incomplete, it was tipped. just survives, as he had done so many times tonight. Garcia stepped up. The defense came to him. He threw it, but this time it was tipped. Was it Gamble who got a piece? What a finish. South Carolina can stop the clock once.
And during this stop, we're going to show you what Garcia missed. Pressure on the road, hostile environment, defense trying to get to you. Garcia just didn't see the field. He had a tailback running around the left side for a touchdown, just couldn't see it.
What a finish. A tough, tough loss for Steve Spurrier on the road. Could have easily won it. But for Mark Richt and the Georgia Bulldogs, what a way to bounce back from a loss on the road a week ago at Oklahoma State. And both quarterbacks had a heck of a night. Been the biggest play of the game, a blocked extra point.
Well, the blocked extra point really was kind of a part of the theme for this whole game of special teams. You know, when you talk about this last play here, watch the back. You know, Brian Maddox, number 10, nobody is covering Maddox. If Garcia had just peeked a little bit to the left, he'd have seen his back. That would have at least gotten the first down.
Who gets a piece of this? The great Rennie Curran. And Garcia can only stand there frustrated. Spurrier thought they had the right call. It looked like they did. Could have thrown it in the flat. Could have tried to run it. It wasn't that he made a bad decision. It's just that the defensive play was better than the offensive play. Let's check in with Heather.
Coach, congratulations on the win. A shootout, certainly not what we expected in this rivalry. What kind of statement did your offense make tonight?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
What kind of statement did your offense make tonight?
Well, we put some points on the board against an outstanding defense. And, of course, our kickoff return team gets sparked us, too. There's a lot of great things that happen and a lot of really bad things that happen. And if you make that many mistakes and still win, it's a blessing.
Coach, how did that blocked PAT really change the complexion of the game?
No question. I mean, it's just, do you know who got it? I don't even know who got it.
I don't either.
God bless him, whoever it is. Awesome.
Coach, what about your defensive stand on the last drive?
Well, you know, the red zone defense was the difference in the game. I mean, twice in the first half, they had to kick field goals. They stopped him here, and I think there's a third time that we forced them to a field goal in the red zone. So red zone defense won it for us.
Huge difference starting the season 1-1 versus 0-2. How can this win propel this team?
Well, you know, football's a game of momentum, and we got the train moving a little bit, so hopefully we can keep it riding.
Enjoy it. Congratulations.
Heather, thank you very much. Once again, the final score, Georgia 41, South Carolina 37. For Craig James, Heather Cox, and our entire crew, this is Mike Patrick. Thanks for watching, everyone. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Now let's send you to the studio with Wendy Nix standing by.